This short video is designed to educate our program partners about two of the key HVAC commissioning tests required for our program, assessing the airflow of the HVAC fan and measuring two electrical parameters of the HVAC equipment. These requirements are contained in Section 8 and Section 9 of the HVAC System Quality Installation Contractor Checklist. My name is Dean Gamble. I'm the Technical Coordinator for EPA's Energy Star Certified Homes Program, and I'll be narrating this video. Throughout this video, you'll see Rob George. He helps provide contract support to the Energy Star Certified Homes Program and has over 30 years of experience in the HVAC industry. So let's get started. You may already know why it's important for the airflow of the HVAC fan to come close to matching the design value. Proper airflow helps ensure that the right amount of heat is transferred between the air and the heating and cooling equipment. This heated and cooled air can then be distributed to each room in the home, keeping the home comfortable with less energy. This is important to get right before completing the other commissioning tests. Static pressure can be used to determine the airflow of the HVAC fan. So let's discuss how you actually measure the static pressure. Perhaps the most challenging part of this process is determining where to locate the holes to measure static pressure. To get the total external static pressure, you need to measure the positive pressure on the supply side of the fan and measure the negative pressure on the return side of the fan. This means you'll need to make two holes or use existing holes. Keep in mind that to measure the external static pressure, you'll need to select one hole before and one hole after the components that the manufacturer considers internal to the equipment. For example, the manufacturer has likely already accounted for the static pressure changes caused by the fan housing and the fan itself. It's also possible that the manufacturer has accounted for the static pressure changes caused by other components if they ship in the same housing as the fan. For example, some manufacturers might account for the static pressure caused by the cooling coil or a factory-installed filter, while others might not. Once you know how the manufacturer has defined external, you can select the locations for the holes that match that definition. In selecting where to locate the holes, try to find usable existing locations first, such as screw holes or wire penetrations. Of course, if you need to drill holes, you'll want to be careful that you not damage the equipment. Again, the manufacturer will often include guidance in their installation manual about where it's safe to drill these holes. We can see here that Rob has found a usable hole on the return side of the system and will not need to drill. If he had needed to, he could have used the drill bit that's just a bit larger than the probe he'll be using. Rob is also marking off this hole with a green flag so that the rater can easily find the hole when he or she duplicates this test. For the return side, he'll be using a simple static pressure probe like this. This probe has a magnetic collar, which makes it easy to hold in place in the ductwork during the test. Now we see that Rob has also found a usable hole in the supply side of the system and will be inserting the probe and marking it off. On the supply side, the probe will often end up being inserted through two layers of metal, which can make it difficult to use the angled static pressure probe. For this reason, Rob has brought along a straight static pressure probe, which looks like this. To measure the static pressure, Rob will be using a digital manometer, which looks like this. A digital manometer is a fast, accurate way to measure the static pressure. You can see that it has two tabs on it. Rob can easily measure just the supply duct static pressure or just the return duct static pressure by attaching a single probe to the manometer. To get the total external static pressure, he could then add the magnitude of these two values together. Alternatively, he could use both taps at the same time, one connected to each probe. This would allow the digital manometer to measure the total external static pressure in just one reading. Rob has already connected the tubing to the probes and turned on the HVAC system so that the fan is operational. He can now measure the external static pressure by connecting the tubing to the manometer. Here we see the results for the total external static pressure test, with both probes connected to the manometer. The total external static pressure of the system is 0.28 inches water column, or IWC. Rob can now determine the airflow of this fan using the blower performance data from the manufacturer. A sample is shown here. Knowing that this fan was set to the medium-low setting and that the measured external static pressure is 0.28 inches water column, the airflow is between 1025 and 1000 CFM. By interpolating, we get a final airflow of 1005 CFM. Rob now removes the probes and plugs the holes with a plug, oil tape, or in the case of wire penetrations, a non-permanent putty. Now, Rob can complete Section 9 of the checklist. In item 9.1, he records that the air volume at the evaporator was 1,005 CFM. In item 9.2, he records that the test was conducted in cooling mode. This will help the rater duplicate this test in the same conditions that the contractor used. In items 9.3 and 9.4, he records the static pressure in the supply duct and return duct and provides a general description of the location of each hole, such as left top of cabinet. Again, this will help the rater easily locate these holes when they duplicate the test. In item 9.5, he checks the box to confirm that the test hole locations are well marked and accessible. Finally, in item 9.6, he confirms that the airflow volume reported in item 9.1 is within 15% of the design airflow reported in item 2.16. While Rob is working at the air handler, he can easily measure the current and voltage at the electrical disconnect or furnace junction box. To do this, he'll be using a digital multimeter, which looks like this. The reason that it's important to do this is that, just like other electronic equipment, like computers and TVs, heating and cooling equipment is designed to operate within certain electrical parameters. If equipment is operating outside these tolerances, then there may be an operational problem or a problem with the power supply. In such cases, the durability and efficiency of the equipment could be compromised. Here we see Rob using the digital multimeter to take the measurements. First, he measures the voltage of the disconnect or furnace junction box, and we can see here that the measured value is 123.2 volts. Now Rob is determining the current at the same location. We can see here that he measures a value of 1.2 amps. Of course, HVAC contractors should always take special care to safely measure electrical characteristics. When comparing these measured values to those in the manufacturer's documentation, Rob finds that they are well within the tolerance. Now Rob can complete item 8.1 of the checklist. He records the current and voltage values that were measured at the evaporator, air handler, fan. Since we are already inside of the air handler, we could do a quick check for one of the values we'll need for section 6, refrigerant tests. That is the returned air wet bulb temperature for item 6.2. But to maintain continuity, we'll cover that on another video. As you can now see, in less than 15 minutes, Rob has checked the airflow of the HVAC fan, as well as measured two key electrical parameters. We've completed all of section 9 and half of section 8 on the checklist. HVAC equipment is an expensive investment for any home and plays a critical role in maintaining comfort and efficiency. Spending 15 additional minutes to conduct these tests is a good investment for contractors, builders, and homeowners. That's why they're required for every home that earns the Energy Star. Plus, contractors that invest in these tools and procedures can provide these valuable services in all new and existing homes.